Good evening, everybody. I'm Steve Call. I'm the Dean of the Journalism School here at Columbia University, and it's my privilege to welcome you to the 2015 Alfred I. DuPont-Columbia University Awards. Welcome. Tonight we'll be honoring the very best in broadcast, digital, and documentary journalism for 2013 and 2014 with 14 awards. We have some alumni from the Journalism School among this year's winners. It makes us very happy. And I'd like to extend a special welcome to those of you who are here with us. Rainey Aronson-Rath has been here before, I imagine. Rainey, welcome. Hazel Gerland Pooler is with us tonight. Congratulations. Robert Little is with us. Marianne McCune. And also Joseph Shapiro is with us tonight. And I know we have other alumni from the Journalism School in the audience here tonight, and I want to welcome you all back. It's good to have you with us. And thank you for taking time away from the State of the Union. We'll try to get you back to your television screens in good order. You'll miss the part where the State of the Union is strong or not, depending on your perspective. So we're live streaming the ceremony, and for those of you who are tweeting, as was mentioned, you can use the hashtag DuPont2015. I'm really pleased to be back here tonight myself because these awards, I think, matter to our field, our profession, more than ever because of the way they model excellence and depth and originality and courage in a business that's obviously changing very quickly. And so I think, in addition to all of the ways that these kinds of awards lift up individuals deservedly after they put in lots of hard work on important projects and the way they reward institutions and collaborations, they also teach and they really model for our field how to keep doing this kind of work amid change. And I think the winners tonight, as you'll see, represent, you know, the really highest values of our profession and a remarkable range. You have this deep historical narrative that we'll honor and see some of, explanatory work, frontline, brave war reporting and conflict reporting, but with real sophistication and nuance, and then local investigative reporting of real verve and bravado and importance. And to see all of that still going on amidst the pressures and the changes in journalism is really very inspiring. We're fortunate to have two veteran broadcast journalists here tonight to present this year's DuPont Awards. The first has spent more than 25 years as a journalist, first in print newspapers and then in television at ABC News Nightline. She joined NPR in 2006 to launch the one-hour daily news and talk show Tell Me More, and that show aired nationwide for 7 years, from 2007 to 2014. Today she can be heard across NPR news programs, and outside this studio she's hosting an ambitious live event series. Please join me in welcoming NPR's Michelle Martin. And our second presenter holds a degree from Columbia University's Law School. After graduating, she worked with our own Fred Friendly at the Journalism School as the executive director of his media and society seminars, many of which were broadcast on PBS. And then she joined Court TV as an anchor and a producer before starting at ABC News in 1994 as the network's legal correspondent. She became anchor for Primetime Live and Nightline at ABC News, and last March, she joined NBC News as the senior legal and investigative reporter. Today, and she contributes to their investigative unit across all of their news platforms. So please join me in welcoming Cynthia McFadden.
Almost missed my cue there. Good evening, everyone. It's great to be here. Thank you, Dean Cole. It's a true delight to be back on the Columbia campus, where I had the dubious pleasure of going to law school and the distinct pleasure of working for Fred W. Friendly, as the dean mentioned. As many in the audience will know, Fred was a pioneer in broadcast journalism, having served as both Edward R. Murrow's producer and as president of CBS News. Those younger members of the audience may know him as that guy that George Clooney played in Good Night and Good Luck. I regret to say, although a giant of a man, Fred did not resemble Mr. Clooney in appearance. Sorry, Fred, but you always said tell the truth. By the time I met Fred in the 1980s, he was a professor here at the Jay School and producing a series of public television programs exploring the thorniest of issues. One of Fred's greatest worries, and he was a worrier, was that once broadcast executives found out how much money they could make doing the worst kinds of journalism, they would never again permit the journalists who work for them to do their best. He railed against turning the news divisions into profit centers and away from their original mandate to operate in the public interest. While Fred certainly had a point, and the pressure of ratings and profits is very real indeed, there is still an astounding amount of outstanding work being produced by both the networks and by an ever-expanding group of people. Just ask the judges. Tonight's winners burst through a myriad of challenges to give us the very best reporting of the year, exposing injustice, inspiring change, and illuminating many dark corners. Or, as Fred would have put it, they were willing to walk through walls to tell a story. Walking through walls has never been more difficult or more important. As we gather tonight to celebrate those who inspire us, let us pause to remember the 61 journalists who died this year were killed for simply doing their jobs. And now to the awards. Our first DuPont winner did something truly remarkable, making 500 years of African-American history come alive in a sweeping six-part series that aired on PBS. Notably, most of those years were before the existence of moving video or even photographs. Presented by renowned Harvard scholar Dr. Henry Louis Gates Jr., this beautifully crafted series explored the evolution of the African-American people, how they forged their own history, culture, and society, often against unimaginable odds. With superb animation, camera work, and writing, the series, The African-Americans, Many Rivers to Cross with Henry Louis Gates Jr., offered viewers of all backgrounds new interpretations of our country's history, encouraging us to reflect on how we became who we are today. Let's take a look at that history from the shores of Sierra Leone in this excerpt from Many Rivers to Cross.
The dehumanization of an entire race was a process requiring many steps. One occurred here. This beautiful island, shrouded in fog, is home to what was once a fortress built by the British in the 1670s.
Out there is the mouth of the Putloko Creek. Mm-hmm. African middlemen used to bring their slaves and goods down the Putloko Creek, through the mouth of the Putloko Creek out there, all the way to this beach here.
So they came right through that gap, right?
Yes, sir.
There.
Yes.
They would bring them here, then march them straight up there and sell.
Up this hill, mm-hmm. up onto the trading area.
Though its walls have long crumbled, I could still get a sense of how this place once worked.
This was the main entrance into the fort. It had a double folding door with a little room patch on top.
British officers lived here in a lavish two-story mansion. The high cost of purchasing even a single slave meant that most masters tried to breed their own labor force. And some went to great lengths to make it happen, from forced pairings of slave couples to rape. Of all the major slave societies in the New World, only in the United States did the slave population naturally increase over time. The 400,000 people that we imported from Africa had become nearly 4 million by the outbreak of the Civil War. The numbers are staggering, and so was the violence required to keep them all under control.
22-year-old Kathleen Neal was working for racial justice through the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. But the rising call for Black Power awakened her desire for something more radical. After meeting Panther Minister of Information, Eldridge Cleaver, Kathleen moved west, married Cleaver, and took charge of communications for the party.
The question is not will it be nonviolence versus violence, but whether a human being can practice his God-given right of self-defense.
The Panthers came up with their own bold new solution to the long-standing problem of police harassment in the ghetto: armed community patrols.
They just assume their Second Amendment rights. They say, we have the right to defend ourselves under this Constitution, and we're going to do it openly and publicly.
We would have power to determine the destiny of our own community. We would not be subjected to police brutality. And that was a pretty direct take in the streets with their weapons, patrolling the police. It was something that the Oakland police had never encountered.
Here to accept our first DuPont Silver Baton, please welcome author, journalist, filmmaker, Harvard professor, Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr.
Thank you. Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you very much. You know, I sat on the board of the Pulitzer Prizes for 9 years, and during that entire time, it never once occurred to me that I could be part of a team that would win its cousin for broadcast journalism, the keenly competitive Alfred I. DuPont-Columbia Award. In January 1968, ladies and gentlemen, I sat in the living room of our working-class home in Piedmont, West Virginia, and watched a documentary on a small black-and-white TV set called Black History, Lost, Stolen, or Straight. And while it was quite fragmentary and it lasted only 1 hour, I was riveted. It was the first time I had heard anything about the subject of black history. It opened up a world of wonder to me. I was hooked in spite of being raised by my mama to be a doctor. You know, my mother thought in heaven there was Jesus and then there were doctors. When I went off to Yale a year later, the first course in which I enrolled was a survey course in African American history, taught by a white man named Professor William McFeely. And I guess in retrospect, the die was cast at that moment. In 1991, I got a call to move to Harvard. And as soon as I got to Harvard, I got a phone call from a guy I didn't know. His name was Henry Hampton. And he asked me to visit his production company named Blackside in the South End of Boston. By the end of that wondrous day, I knew that in my heart of hearts, I wanted to make documentary films, films as great as Henry Hampton's Eyes on the Prize. I just had no idea how this fantasy could ever be realized. Well, the Bible says, be careful what you wish for. It did come true, and we made the African Americans Many Rivers to Cross because no one since 1968 had ever tried to tell the full sweep of African American history in one documentary series. Why was that important? Well, as the great Arthur Schomburg wrote in 1925, and I quote, the American Negro must remake his past in order to make his future. And though it's orthodox to think of America, he continued, as the country where it's unnecessary to have a past, what is a luxury for the nation as a whole becomes a prime social necessity for the Negro. For him, a group tradition must supply compensation for persecution and pride of race, the antidote for prejudice. History, he concluded, must restore what slavery took away, for it's the social damage of slavery that the present generations must repair and offset. To do this difficult work of repairing and offsetting, a teacher, which is, as Cynthia said, my day job, a teacher needs tools in the classroom, and nothing is as effective, as immediate, as being able to teach through a powerful documentary film. So we set off to do something that no one had done before, to tell the history of people of African descent in this country, not since Jamestown, but the whole sweep of the black presence here starting 500 years ago when the first black man who incredibly was not even a slave, a free black man who was a conquistador, amazingly enough, set foot in Florida in the first decade of the 16th century. And we ended with the re-election of Barack Obama. So let me thank, in conclusion, the people who deserve the credit for this achievement, my amazingly dynamic, endlessly inventive, and deeply loving partner, Dylan McGee, more of a sister and alter ego than a partner, and Peter Kuhnhart, Rachel Dretson, our brilliantly creative senior series producer, Asako Gladstow, our deeply reflective senior story producer, along with the other members of what I think of as our dream team, Sabin Streeter, Jamila Wignott, Phil Bertelsen, and Beth Hoppe and Bill Gardner at PBS. And I want to thank our funders, the steadfast and courageous Pat Harrison and Jennifer Lawson at the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the captain of PBS, Paula Kerger, and my friends who are here, Howard and Abby Milstein, Dr. Georgette Bennett, Leonard Polonsky, Richard Gilder, Darren Walker at the Ford Foundation, and a host of other funders that I don't have time to acknowledge. Just think about the events at Ferguson, Staten Island, and the Black Lives Matter campaign. It's clear to me that the great span of black history has never had more relevance, ladies and gentlemen, than it does right now, this evening. Maya Angelou put it best when she said, and I quote, that history, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again. As my role model, Henry Hampton, put it, looking back, it's clear to me that history is the high ground in the battle for self. And without a sense of self, one's freedom is forever in the hands of others. The importance of history to a disenfranchised people, he concluded, cannot be gainsaid. And this is why we dedicated Many Rivers to Cross in memory of the man who first inspired me to dream the dream of making documentary films, the much beloved and much missed Henry Hampton. The Alfred I. duPont-Columbia Award is, along with the Peabody's, the creme de la creme broadcast journalism prizes. I cannot adequately tell you how much this honor means to me this evening and what a fantasy it is. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Traditionally, these awards honor outstanding video journalism across platforms. That includes local television news stations who serve as watchdogs for their communities, like our second DuPont Award winner, WFTS-TV Tampa. Their investigation into Florida's guardianship program affects tens of thousands of the elderly in Pinellas County. The ABC Action News I-team zealously followed up on a tip and launched a series of reports that exposed rampant abuse by court-appointed guardians. They broadcast disturbing stories of elderly men and women stripped of their rights and property by self-serving guardians operating without adequate oversight. As a result of the series, a new guardianship reform bill led to legislative changes in Florida to help protect these most vulnerable people. The jury called the reporting compelling and exemplary. And this clip from WFTS-TV series Incapacitated, Florida's guardianship program, will see just how powerless the elderly can be.
She kept a beautiful house, and she always dressed nicely.
Nancy Lewy is describing Paulette Carpa, her former neighbor known for taking long walks, gardening, and weekly card games.
I mean, she took care of herself and was able to take care of herself.
I love you much.
But in 2009, Carpa's life changed after making a series of calls from her house to police about attempted burglaries. Each turned out to be unfounded. DCF was called. Soon after, professional guardian Patricia Johnson asked the court to have Carpa declared incapacitated, even though Carpa had made prior arrangements for a family member to care for her. In Florida, the courts can give guardians complete control over their wards. They can sell their homes, they can close their bank accounts, they can even choose where their wards live. The I-team discovered a complaint in Carpa's court file sent by Senior Citizen Services of Clearwater after Johnson allowed Carpa's power to be shut off.
And suddenly this 86-year-old lady was living in a home without electricity, without air conditioning and so forth, and she didn't know what to do because The bank account had been closed.
The nonprofit organization tried to help CARPA, contacting her niece, Alicia Hackerson, in Massachusetts, who was listed in pre-need plan documents CARPA signed 3 years earlier as a person chosen to handle her aunt's affairs. Hackerson says she never heard from the courts or Johnson.
They did not contact the family. They had all the information, all the people that were supposed to be contacted.
When Hackerson learned about her aunt's situation, she asked the court to be granted guardianship, as CARPA had originally arranged, but the judge ruled against her.
And the court, I guess, put the papers away and never acknowledged anybody that was listed there.
Every one of my people who were involved in this situation and had knowledge of it were just shocked by the fact that this could be happening. We didn't think it was possible.
But the I-team has reported there are other complaints involving guardian Patricia Johnson and her 50 other wards, including 99-year-old Willie Burchow, who says Patty forced him into an Alzheimer's unit.
You see nobody. You have no contact with anybody.
After we recently started asking questions about Willie's case, Johnson moved him out of the Alzheimer's unit and to a less restrictive wing at Grand Villa. Grand Villa is also where Paulette CARPA was placed by Johnson.
If it wasn't for you contacting me, I would not even know where she was today, because Patricia never informed us of where she was being taken or anything like that.
Nancy Leewe has her pre-need guardian plan naming family members close by in hopes that the court will honor it if she ever needs it.
We are more afraid of the word guardian than we are of the word cancer.
Wow. Here to accept. Here to accept the DuPont baton for WFTS, please welcome investigative reporter Adam Walser. Adam.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. That last soundbite was the greatest one I've ever gotten in my career, by the way. When we thought about that, that's an incredible way to sum up the fear of this program that has targeted so many elderly people. I'd like to thank ABC Action News and Scripps for supporting this kind of high quality journalism. It takes a lot of resources, a lot of time. Sometimes the ratings aren't always there for something involving elderly people who are locked up and denied their rights, but they had faith in us and let us go through and follow this for months and months wherever it would lead. Our initial story focused on then 99-year-old Willie Burchow, who you saw there at the end of that piece. He's going to be 101 years old in April. He had escaped from Stalinist Russia and Nazi Germany to eventually lose his freedom to a professional guardian in the state of Florida. After his wife died, Willie had no family in the United States and was found to be incapacitated after a short exam of about 5 minutes by a psychiatrist after he tried to sell his home for too low of a price. A stranger, Mrs. Johnson, who you saw there in the piece, petitioned the court to take away his rights and eventually placed him in an Alzheimer's unit where he did not belong. When we interviewed Willie, it was immediately apparent that this is somebody of sound mind. We kept fighting for him, and eventually he was freed. And as we continued to dig, we discovered many others like him who were isolated from family members, ignored by their court-appointed guardians. At the same time, they were being exploited for financial gain. Through our reporting, Willie was eventually freed. He's a happy man now and almost 101 years old. And his story helped pass a law that will hopefully help others who are in his same situation. But guardianship abuse isn't going away. Nationally, it's a multi-billion dollar industry that will continue to grow as our population ages, and abuse will continue if stronger controls are not enacted. Thank you very much.
And now I'm going to pass the metaphorical baton to NPR's Michelle Martin, who joins me in presenting the awards tonight. Michelle.
Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you. Our next two awards honor outstanding local investigative reporting that held officials accountable for abuses of power. The first is from KPNX 12 News in Phoenix, where the city's fire department claimed to have the highest arson clearance rate of any major American city. Reporter Wendy Halloran and the station's I-team relentlessly pursued and ultimately refuted that claim after they discovered the arson team's over-reliance on a dog had led to the unjust prosecution of at least four innocent people. One woman spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on legal bills and lost her home. The KPNX team uncovered tapes that showed the dog trainer drawing his own conclusions even when the dog found nothing. Their reporting triggered an FBI investigation and the early retirement of the fire chief. In this clip, Halloran's persistence pays off when she finally gets him to agree to an interview. Let's take a look at KPNX 12's Phoenix investigation, raked over the coals.
When we sat down and spoke earlier this month, our conversation centered on the arson squad and details he apparently wasn't aware of.
You didn't know anything about this?
No, ma'am.
What Chief Kahn didn't know much about was the department's arson-sniffing dog, a secret weapon, who, according to his handler, never gets it wrong.
Show me. Show me better. Should be a lot more than that, though, huh, Sammy?
You think, wouldn't there?
No, you gotta put your nose down. At least fake it for me, okay?
Is that appropriate?
No, it's embarrassing. That he used that phrase is embarrassing, I think, for all of us. It is for myself.
Captain Fred Andes is the dog's handler. Last year, he was awarded Arson Investigator of the Year from the Phoenix Fire Department. In the video you just saw, Barbara Sloan, the woman whose house burned down, ended up being arrested and charged with arson. After 2 years and $300,000 of her money, her case was dismissed by the Maricopa County Attorney in the interests of justice.
I lost almost everything because of it.
Prosecutors reviewing Sloan's case concluded lead investigator Captain Sam Richardson, who shot the video of Captain Andes and the dog, was an inexperienced fire investigator. Richardson would admit he arrested Sloan solely because she was the homeowner. He had no evidence tying her to the fire.
Accepting the DuPont Award for Raked Over the Coals, please welcome Senior Investigative Reporter Wendy Halloran.
Okay. So Wendy has an entourage, but it's not like HBO. This is our team. I'm Mark Casey. I'm the Vice President, Station Manager, and former News Director at 12 News. Wendy Halloran reported the story. Jeff Blackburn handled photography along with Brian West, who did a lot of document digging and digital storytelling. Mark Phillips was the primary content editor. And I pitched in to make sure we tapped our tremendous legal resources and to run some interference with City Hall. These folks made it happen. It was a tough slog against a fire department that a community wanted to believe could do no wrong. The pushback that Wendy and this team endured was very intense, and they did not give up because they were committed to keeping people who had done no wrong out of jail. We can't do this kind of journalism in local news without the commitment of people like Gannett Broadcasting CEO Dave Lugi. Dave was a news director not too long ago, and he still thinks like one. And that's great to have somebody like that leading our company. We also can't do this kind of journalism without Gannett Broadcasting's tremendous legal team. Barbara Wall and Mark Ferris are not only tremendous First Amendment lawyers, they're pretty good editors. The same goes for our local counsel, David Bodney and Chris Meeser, thanks to them. You're seeing some local news at its best tonight, and I'm proud to work in local news. We're often parodied and ridiculed, like with Ron Burgundy. And sometimes we deserve that. But there is very good journalism being done at local TV stations around the country, and certainly at the Gannett stations. Our communities need us. When a fire department arson team goes off the rails in Phoenix, Arizona, somebody has to hold them accountable, and that's what we do. Wendy and this team have done the same with the Arizona Department of Corrections, with the Mesa, Arizona Police Department, and the Paradise Valley School District, and the list goes on. Local work like this keeps us plenty busy, and we're very fortunate in Phoenix that we have a great team like this one. with outstanding support at our station with our president and general manager, John Meisner, and all the way to the top of our company. Thanks to Columbia and those who judged our team to be among the best, we're thankful and we're humbled, and we plan on being back next year.
My father was a fire marshal in this city, and that story had a lot of personal resonance for me. So I thank you for your hard work in keeping everyone accountable who needs to be held accountable. So thank you for that. Let me tell you a little bit about the process, which two of our award winners have already alluded to. This year, the DuPont jury selected 14 winners from more than 610 television, radio, and digital entries, the largest number of entries in a decade. Before the jury met, close to 100 screeners, many of them former DuPont winners, evaluated the entries. Altogether, the DuPont jurors watched more than 200 hours of programming. They met at Columbia over the course of 3 days in October to select the winners. Members of the jury, we would love for you to stand so that we can thank you for your hard work. And we thank you because your time and dedication was not just about watching a lot of programs and listening to a lot of programs. It was about upholding standards for the profession and for the public. So we thank you for that. And a hallmark of these DuPont Awards is honoring outstanding reporting that shines a light in dark places, as I think Cynthia said earlier. Our next award continues that tradition. Betrayed by Silence from Minnesota Public Radio was a year-long cross-platform investigation that exposed how leaders of the Twin Cities Archdiocese continue to cover up abuse of children by priests. This despite decades of assurances that the Catholic Church was safe. The reporters found that bishops provided secret payments to pedophiles, that they hid the names of abusers, and failed to notify police of alleged sex crimes as recently as 2012. The NPR News investigation featured reporting on radio and online with interactive databases of allegations against priests and where they served, church documents, police and court records, and victim settlements, all showing the extent of the cover-up. As a result of NPR's reporting, a criminal investigation has been opened against the Archdiocese. There have been resignations, forced retirements, firings, and the names of abusive priests have been released. The team is still reporting on breaking news. Just last week, the Archdiocese declared bankruptcy. In this excerpt that we're going to see now, we'll hear some of those priests, including one who collected his church pension for years with bonus payments, despite admitting to child abuse. Let's look.
At every step of the way, this could have been prevented. This is just failure after failure after failure after failure.
Hasselberger is speaking publicly for the first time. For 5 years, she worked as the canon lawyer for the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis. It was her job to advise the Archbishop on the laws of the Roman Catholic Church, which includes specific rules on confronting grave sins, like child abuse. Hasselberger's concern with Father Wehmeyer began in 2008, when she checked his personnel file on a routine matter. She realized Wehmeyer had a sex addiction, and the Archdiocese knew about it.
Nobody at the parish was told, look out.
And they were supposed to be told that.
Yes.
He was known as the Polka Padre.
I've got a never-ending love for you. From now on, that's all I want to do.
Robert Capone was ordained a priest in the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis in 1964 and served in 7 parishes. Capone played his accordion and performed what he called polka masses at churches throughout the Twin Cities. The Polka Padre later became known in the media as the Polka Predator, when young men came forward in the late 80s and early 90s to sue Capone and the Archdiocese for sexual abuse they say they suffered as children. An NPR News investigation has found that the Archdiocese allowed Capone to take medical retirement and gave him an extra $957 a month above and beyond his pension. Those extra payments from 1998 to 2012 added up to more than $160,000. Capone still lives on this property in Cold Spring and winters in Florida. The $500,000 home is secluded. It's one of the places where Capone abused young boys. On a recent afternoon, Capone was taking care of some yard work. He jumped off the lawnmower to answer a few questions.
What can I do for you?
He's a trim 74-year-old with a full head of white hair and dark sunglasses. Because of his history of abuse, Capone is supposed to be carefully monitored. I asked him about it.
Do you have any contact with the Archdiocese still?
About once a month.
Okay. So does someone come visit you, or how does that work?
Well, not really. We just get together, you know, at different times.
So is it who? So it's someone.
But I just meet with a priest that I want to up here or wherever.
Is it that monitoring program?
No.
Here to accept the DuPont Award, please welcome NPR News lead reporter Madeline Barron.
Thank you so much for this award. This means a lot to me and to the entire reporting team who worked tirelessly on this investigation now for more than a year. And throughout, we were reminded of the importance of challenging the claims of powerful institutions, in this case, the Catholic Church, which in the Twin Cities had convinced parishioners, the public, and reporters that the clergy sex abuse scandal was a thing of the past, and that in fact there was no safer place for a child than within the Catholic Church. What our investigation found was that that was not true. And I'm very grateful to the survivors of sexual abuse and their families who are so generous with their time and allowing us to tell these stories. And thank you.
The next pair of silver batons will be awarded to NPR. The first for an investigative radio series that highlights the violation of one of our founding legal principles, that we're all equal before the law. In Guilty and Charged, NPR's six-part series, reporter Joseph Shapiro uncovered a hidden two-tier justice system that effectively creates debtors' prisons in states across the country. He showed how defendants are now charged for a long list of services that were once free, including the cost of a public defender. These fees and costs can add up to thousands of dollars. When defendants can't pay, they end up behind bars, despite the Supreme Court's rulings that such practices are illegal. To tell this important story, Shapiro found rare sources of data, courtroom tapes, and conducted original research that brought the reporting to life. In this excerpt from NPR's Guilty and Charged, we'll hear more about the kinds of fees that land poor people in jail.
We found that on a typical day, about 25% of those people in the county jail are there not for their misdemeanor offenses, but because they failed to pay the court fines and fees. Twice a week, the courts in Benton County call scores and scores of people to appear and explain why they failed to pay.
Your Honor, if I could next call Barry Smith.
These are people who say they're too poor to pay fines and fees that routinely reach hundreds or even thousands of dollars. People like Stephen Papa. He served in Iraq with the Army National Guard, but when he came home to Michigan in 2012, he couldn't find a job. He was homeless, counting on friends to give him a couch to sleep on. Papa admits he was wrong that day last August when he and some friends spent the day drinking. Papa speaks from the Kent County Jail in Grand Rapids, Michigan. He was sentenced to 22 days, not for what he did that day he was drunk, but because he couldn't pay his court debt. In a recording from the court session last September, Grand Rapids District Court Judge Benjamin Logan says he wants $50, but Papa had only $25.
Wrong answer. My expectation is $50, and I just sent three people to jail. Didn't happen.
The judge wanted a first payment on the $2,600 that Papa was charged in restitution, fines, and court fees. The judge said Papa could have made money by picking up cans to recycle. Just the week before, Stephen Papa had found a job, a good one, paying $12 an hour making steel shelves. He told the judge he'd get his first paycheck at the end of the week, and then he'd have the money to pay.
Well, I just wanted to add, Your Honor, like, I've been trying. I tried really hard to get this job, and I'd really like to keep it.
But he wasn't sure that job would be waiting if he spent 3 weeks in jail. Still, that's where the judge sent him, and added a condition to his probation for when he got out.
You're to maintain stable employment, provide proof thereof.
In other words, if Papa didn't have a job when he got out, he'd be in violation of his probation and could go back to jail.
Yikes. Here to accept the DuPont Award for NPR's Guilty and Charged, please welcome correspondent Joseph Shapiro.
Wow, that was a report.
Yes. Heavy.
On the train this morning, I was reading the new book by attorney Brian Stevenson, who represents indigent defendants. And he writes, the opposite of poverty isn't wealth. The opposite of poverty is justice. NPR's investigation, Guilty and Charged, told the story of how cash-strapped courts, states, and municipalities have come to fund themselves by charging user fees, even on traffic violations and other minor criminal infractions. Defendants, and most of them are poor, they get charged hundreds or even thousands of dollars. And in one Michigan county, we found impoverished defendants paid for the courtroom heat, the security, the phones, even for the employee's fitness gym. In 43 states, there's even a fee to get a public defender. If people struggle to pay, and often they will, there are added financial penalties. 12% interest in Washington state, where people lose a driver's license or other public benefits. And the poor who fail to pay can go to jail, even though debtors' prisons were outlawed in this country before the Civil War. We had a great team at NPR that made this happen. Bob Little, our investigations editor, producer Nicole Binsterbauer, Robert Benincasa, our computer-assisted reporting producer, Barbara Van Workum, our lead researcher, Alicia Cypress, our web producer, Emma Anderson, our reporter, and also I want to thank executive editor Madhulika Sikka and our acting senior vice president for news, Chris Turpin. And one last point, 5 years ago this month, NPR started an investigative unit, funded it, put together a great staff, gave us freedom, and continued NPR's commitment to journalism of importance, the kind of reporting that gets celebrated here by the DuPont Awards. Thank you.
Our next DuPont winner explores the complex world behind the creation of a simple item of clothing we all wear, the t-shirt. To get that story, teams at NPR's Planet Money and NPR Visuals launched an ambitious online project that took them across four continents and on the way explained the global economics behind the manufacturing of that wardrobe staple. 3 years in the making and crowdsourced, the team used different media to tell different parts of the story as they designed and sold their own t-shirt. Dazzling cinematography shows the lives of low-wage earners, and accessible text lays out economic concepts. With compelling and versatile writing in a radio series, an interactive documentary, and in podcasts, the jury called the project a tour de force. Let's take a quick tour around the world with Planet Money Makes a T-shirt.
We wanted to tell the story of our clothes the way the vast majority of our clothes are actually made. Because behind all of our clothes, behind this shirt, there is an entire world. And once you see that world, you realize there's nothing ordinary about a simple t-shirt. Our t-shirts started here, or near here anyway, on a cotton farm in the Mississippi Delta. America, it turns out, exports more cotton than any other country in the world. For about a century, America maintained its cotton dominance by using slave labor. Today, it does so using technology.
It's a place halfway around the world, a factory in Indonesia called Indorama. And so we packed our bags and we went.
Anil Tibberwal, he's the chief sales guy at Indorama, and he met us at the factory gate.
So Anil takes us into the plant itself. It's big as a football field, and there is hardly a worker in sight.
These are beautiful machines. They are like immaculate.
And very expensive.
Very expensive, he says. And here's what all those machines do. The cotton gets sucked into sort of a long, thick rope. It's like an infinite ponytail. And this ponytail dips and swirls above our heads. And I reach out and grab a little bit of it. Feels like cotton candy.
It's so light. And if you touch it, it almost falls apart. It's so fragile.
4 million people in Bangladesh work in the garment industry. That's double the number from a decade ago. Which raises a question. What has driven 4 million people to work long hours in these factories for some of the lowest wages in the world? To answer that question, we went back with Jasmine to the village where she grew up. A lot of garment workers come from villages like Jasmine's, where people worry about getting enough food to eat, and sometimes don't, and where girls are seen as an economic burden. The solution? Find a husband with the means to support your daughter. But finding a good husband costs money, a dowry. And Jasmine's family, her older sister's dowry, sent the family into debt.
And here they are tonight. Alex Blumberg and Brian Boyer are here to accept the DuPont baton for Planet Money Makes a T-shirt. Congratulations. Great report.
Thank you so much. Hi. For most of human history, we lived in villages. We died in the villages where we were born. We knew everybody for all our lives. If we ran into a stranger, we would either run away or fight. Today we don't live in a world like that. We live in a world that is huge and global. And it's tempting to think that the people are sort of removed from that world. The purpose of this project was to actually find the people that are part of our lives, that make the food we eat and the clothes that we wear. And it was to do a story that big took a large team at NPR and one of the most talented teams I've ever been privileged to work with, the incredibly, incredibly charismatic and talented crew at Planet Money, the unbelievably talented people on the NPR visuals team, the wonderful Josh Davis. This was one of the most exciting and thrilling projects I've ever worked on, and it was made that way because of all of you. So thank you very much, and thank you very much for the award. It's very exciting.
So glad he was wearing a t-shirt. The second of our digital winners also traveled the globe for their story, starting with hometown Seattle. They went as far as Papua New Guinea to report on new threats to the planet in an immersive multimedia project. Sea change, the Pacific's perilous turn, illuminated a rarely discussed consequence of global warming, ocean acidification. With lush visuals and clear writing, this little-known but critical issue was beautifully presented and effectively explained. Immersive storytelling, as you will see, in the truest sense of the word. In this excerpt, witness the impact of rising CO2 emissions on Washington's oyster industry and around the globe.
Hey,
A few years ago, Washington's oyster industry nearly collapsed, exposing a haunting truth about the world's oceans. Kathleen's family business nearly dissolved beneath her feet. The seawater that once nourished their oysters, both on the mudflats and in hatcheries where they buy their oyster larvae, instead had started to kill them. The reason? Rising CO2 emissions from our cars and power plants is changing the chemistry of the sea. This phenomenon, known as ocean acidification, was always expected to hit shelled creatures hard, but that wasn't supposed to happen until late in the century. Instead, it's happening now.
In 2008, when we didn't get anything from the hatcheries, they were completely shut down for weeks at a time. And that was huge for us. Our farm struggled for the first few years. And so that really put our farm on the spot and my parents on the spot to be able to figure out what they were going to do to be able to have a healthy business for me, for future generations, my kids.
Knowing the problem would only get worse, Kathleen's parents took a radical step. They built their own hatchery in Hawaii, which draws water from underground rather than from the sea. They became, in a sense, ocean acidification's first refugees. To better predict how acidification will affect other marine creatures, scientists in Papua New Guinea, on the other side of the Pacific Ocean, are studying underwater vents that release carbon dioxide bubbles below coral reefs. The bubbles create pockets of water where the chemistry mirrors ocean acidification.
So it really presents a natural laboratory to study the effects of ocean acidification on coral reefs, like nowhere else in the world.
Coral reefs are more than just beautiful. They are incredibly important, providing homes and food for thousands of creatures. A quarter of the world's fish rely on corals at some point during their lives. But CO2 from the bubble sites is helping turf-like algae, seagrass, and slime crowd out the reefs, making life extremely difficult for corals and the creatures that live there. But it's not just where fish live that is at risk. Working mostly with clownfish, researchers figured out that carbon dioxide can change a fish's brain, scrambling its hearing, its sight, and its sense of smell, even the likelihood it will turn left or right.
Right.
That leads these CO2-altered fish to die more often than fish in normal water. The problem isn't unique to the tropics. Back across the Pacific Ocean, researchers in the Northwest are finding similar effects on the most important fish in America, pollock, which makes up half the nation's catch of fish.
Please welcome Seattle Times video editor Danny Golowski.
Thank you. Our entire video production team is here tonight, and most of our web development team is here tonight, too. And so as one of the smaller organizations being recognized tonight, I just want to say that we are particularly humbled and we are particularly grateful. I want to thank the local ownership of the Seattle Times and the Pulitzer Center for supporting our aspirations. I want to thank the DuPont jury for recognizing non-traditional video. And I want to thank all of you for helping us highlight ocean acidification as a global issue. I also want to thank photographer Steve Ringman and reporter Craig Welch, who couldn't be here tonight. Thank you.
The environment and the battle for the Earth's resources are also featured in our next winner. It is the first of two documentary films we are honoring tonight, and it is the first time a streaming service, Netflix, will receive a silver baton. Set in the forested depth of eastern Congo, Virunga dramatically captures biodiversity, political intrigue, and conflict. An embattled team of park rangers struggle to protect the Virunga National Park from armed militia, poachers, and forces battling for control of Congo's resources. With brilliant and shocking use of hidden cameras, the filmmakers exposed high levels of corruption. The drama played out in real time, featuring real danger, as well as beautifully tender scenes of man's relationship to the natural world. Just last week, Virunga was also nominated for an Oscar for this year's Best Documentary Film. Not that that's more important than us, because it's really not. But Let's take a look at Virunga.
Dans le monde entier, c'est dans cette entité là où vous pouvez encore trouver les gorilles des montagnes.
Now we assume mining wells. It's just a fucking mining spot.
Could be colossal.
It
is colossal.
Mining is full out. And now when they defend, I'm not sure it's all the animals. I'm not sure at all.
It ain't gorillas, but it's not.
I don't think it could be so highly involved in and do the shit they do.
Unless they're shitting diamonds and fucking pissing iron ore, they don't give a fuck about them. Fuck me, it's a monkey. Who gives a fuck about a fucking monkey?
Ici.
Oui.
Je voulais juste savoir, pour la nourriture, pour les gorilles, on a combien de jours devant nous?
Et deux jours comme ça.
Les M23 sont à Roubaré, ok? S'ils ferment Moiro, ok?
Oui.
Nous, on va devoir se débrouiller ici.
Mwenye anasikia jina yake na batoto yake anapita pembeni na bichi yake mimi na hiyo.
Here to accept the DuPont Award for Virunga, please welcome Director Orlando von Einsiedel. Thank you. So, on behalf of the whole filmmaking team and our partners, not least Netflix, we're truly honored to accept this award. With all that happened during the making of this film, I never could have imagined being here this evening. It's been dangerous and difficult and often very scary, and my thoughts tonight turn to the brave rangers and communities of Virunga National Park who were so generous in allowing us to capture their incredible work and share their story with the world. They're still putting their lives on the line each and every day to protect a part of our planet for all of us. This project has always been about more than just a film for us, because what's happening in Virunga National Park has implications for all of humanity. We must protect the last of the world's mountain gorillas, and we mustn't allow United Nations designated World Heritage Sites like Virunga to fall victim to corporate interests like those of billion-dollar oil company SoCo International. It's a true David and Goliath battle, and we remain deeply concerned for those on the ground fighting to uphold the rule of law, human rights, and governance under the most extreme circumstances. Virunga National Park is setting an example in how to combat the issues facing us all in the conflict between resource extraction and development. Our hope is that this award continues to generate awareness about the struggle going on in Virunga and inspires those of you maybe in this room or beyond to look deeper into the troubling questions in our film. Thank you so much. We're humbled and honored by this award. Thank you. Please welcome back to the podium, Dean Cole.
So when you watch the Oscars, just remember to say you saw it here first. I'd like to acknowledge an alum I left off in my earlier congratulations, Jacob Goldstein, and I'd like now, I'd like now also to acknowledge the staff and trustees from the Jesse Ball DuPont Fund who are here with us tonight. You make possible such excellent journalism and to honor such obviously enormously talented people doing important work at different stages of their careers. And we're very grateful, but you also, by carrying out the legacy of Jesse Ball DuPont to honor her husband, Alfred I. DuPont, you help us enroll here at Columbia at two students on partial scholarships every year. And we call them our DuPont Fellows. There are a number of them, past and present, who I want to introduce to you now through this short tribute video.
I'm Asta Chaturvedi, a journalism student at Columbia University. 80 years ago this April, American industrialist, financier, and philanthropist Alfred I. DuPont died, leaving behind his devoted widow, Jesse Ball DuPont.
I'm Rebecca Lee. Jesse Ball DuPont wanted to create a tribute to her husband and his commitment to freedom of information.
I'm Patty Guerra. 8 years after Alfred's death, the first DuPont Awards ceremony went live on the air from the St. Regis Hotel in New York.
America goes to war.
World War II was raging. I'm Sarah Jorgensen. Those earliest awards were a testament to broadcast journalists covering the world during a critical time.
In another part of the camp, they showed me the children. One rolled up his sleeve, showed me his number. It was tattooed on his arm.
Back then, broadcast meant radio. I'm Sana Bey. In 1950, the DuPont Awards expanded to include television. Jesse Ball DuPont herself gave the first TV award to Walter Annenberg.
I'm Monica Alba. Times continue to change. Today, DuPonts are also awarded for cable, digital, and documentary.
But the rigorous standards remain the same. Journalism is first and foremost. I'm Julie Percha. In these critical times, all of us look to DuPont winners as role models to uphold the tradition of excellence in reporting. At the Washington Post.
At Al Jazeera America.
At CNN.
At NBC News.
Thank you to the Jesse Ball DuPont Fund.
Thank you, Jesse Ball DuPont Fund.
Thank you, Jesse Ball DuPont Fund.
And thanks also to Lisa Cohen for producing that video. Please join me now in thanking the trustees and staff of the Jesse Ball DuPont Fund. If you'll please stand when I say your name. Trustees who are with us this evening, Marty Lanahan, David Llewellyn, Kitty Phillips, and President Sherry McGill. Now I'm pleased to introduce our second documentary winner of the evening, an engaging film that explores the laws of physics and the joy of scientific discovery. The team of physicists and filmmakers behind Particle Fever spent 6 years on the project. Ultimately, they recorded a major scientific discovery, finding the mysterious, long sought-after Higgs boson. The filmmakers succeeded in making the deepest, most important questions of physics exciting and accessible to a general audience by using stunning cinematography, narrative storylines, and clever, artful graphics. In this excerpt, we'll witness an experimental high point in the painstaking search for Higgs boson.
Ever since I entered physics, people have been talking about this machine. The Large Hadron Collider, the biggest machine ever built by human beings, is finally going to turn on. And after many, many years of waiting and theorizing about how matter got created and about what the deep fundamental theory of nature is. All those theories are finally going to be tested. And we're going to know something. And we don't know what it's going to be now, but we will know, and it's going to change everything.
So the LHC is basically the most fundamental of experiments. It's like what any child would design as an experiment. You take two things, and you smash them together. And you get a lot of stuff that comes out of that collision, and you try to understand that stuff. Now, in this case, what we're smashing together is tiny protons, which are inside the center of every atom. And in order to get them going as fast as possible, we have to build this huge 17-mile ring. And we run those protons around the ring multiple times to build up speed, almost to the speed of light. And then we collide two beams going in opposite directions at four points. And at those four points are four different experiments: ATLAS, LHCb, CMS, and ELISE. Now, I work on the ATLAS experiment. And ATLAS is like a huge seven-story camera that takes a snapshot of every single collision. And that's billions of collisions. And the hope is that we'll see the very famous Higgs particle. But every time we've turned on a new accelerator at a higher energy, we've always been surprised. So the real hope is that we'll see the Higgs, but that there's also something amazingly new.
Let's get started, everybody. Now comes the day of reckoning. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, now. No beam. Yeah. So where are we with the injection kicker? Okay. Never mind. Let's go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We get a beam on this pulse?
I hope so.
Please join me in welcoming to the stage director Mark Levinson and producer David Kaplan.
You first, you were first.
Yes. Hello. This is unexpected. This is an incredibly inspiring group of people. For the outsiders, where neither of us are journalists, but to experience the height of journalism not only puts me in awe, but gives me great hope. And physics is a place where there is great hope, because it comes from pure inspiration. And we really are starting from a place where we are curious. And we wanted to do something a little bit different. We and our amazing team, some fraction of them are here, we wanted to do something which showed the humanity of searching for scientific truth. And that was a goal. It's something we hadn't seen precisely in that way. And that's what we wanted to achieve, and this amazing group of people we felt did it. And we're very happy about that. And my colleagues in the physics world, thank goodness, were very happy about what we presented too. We make a lot of analogies between physics and other fields. It's very much like art. It's very much like other human endeavors. I really think that basic scientific research and investigative journalism really share something at the core, because neither you nor us have a goal specifically of what we want to find. We are in the truth business, and that's all we're supposed to do. Whatever result we come up with is the thing we're supposed to find out. We can't have a predetermined idea of what we're going to discover. And the open-mindedness
that lives in the physics world is something we wanted to convey. So thank you. And I'm going to break a rule. I'm going to tell Mark to talk too.
Thank you. I'm going to follow the precedent and not thank the various people like Andrew Miller and Carter Solomon and Claudia Rush Robinson and Wolfgang Held and Thomas Jackson who helped us. But I actually want to thank all of you people who, and reiterating what David said, that we're all, in a sense, we're in the truth business. I mean, that's what probably all these projects were motivated by, wanting to tell the truth. And I think in recent years, it's become even more complicated. I mean, there's so much information out there. We have to get above the din. The recent activities in Paris actually put a sort of almost a mortal obstacle in our way that we have to think about. And so I think it's especially important for an organization like the DuPonts that we get encouragement to disseminate truth and knowledge and understanding. And I thank you all for that support. Thank you.
I want to tell you guys that my 16-year-old son said, "Mom, you got to watch. I saw the most incredible film." I couldn't imagine what it was, and it was Particle Fever, which he made me sit down and watch with him, and I don't understand it, but I certainly enjoyed it. Okay. Here's another one I watched with my 16-year-old son. Another winner this year tackled the tough challenge of making important science accessible to the public. The debate over the perils and potential benefits of medical marijuana took center stage when CNN aired two groundbreaking documentaries, Weed, Dr. Sanjay Gupta's reports, and Weed 2. For 2 years, CNN's chief medical correspondent, Dr. Sanjay Gupta, a practicing neurosurgeon, and a team of producers traveled around the world taking a critical look at the research and chronicling the impact of medical marijuana on the lives of those who use it. With compelling personal cases, first in one groundbreaking primetime broadcast, and then in a following up hour, CNN illustrated how medical marijuana can heal and help when traditional drugs, often harmful, do not. The programs also examined the politics of pot and took a critical look at its recreational use. Shortly after Weed aired, New Jersey Governor Chris Christie signed a law allowing medical marijuana use in children in his state. In this clip, we hear about one family's fight to get medical marijuana treatment for their child and see what motivated the follow-up hour. Take a look.
We've seen her flatline in the hospital. We've said goodbye.
You're listening to Matt and Paige Figge describe their own daughter. What would you do if this were your child? Charlotte Figge had an extreme form of epilepsy. Her body was so frail that any seizure could kill her. With no traditional treatment left to try and the clock ticking away, her parents decided to try marijuana. Charlotte was just 5 years old.
You need a card in order to be able to get the cannabis from a pharmacy. Doctors have to prescribe it.
You need two doctors in Colorado to get the card for a juvenile or a child. It was hard. We were the first young child, and they said no. Everyone said no.
Certainly her age played a role in my hesitance.
Dr. Alan Shackelford is a Harvard-trained physician. He's also among a handful of doctors in Colorado who give prescriptions for medical marijuana. From the moment Charlotte entered his office, he knew she was in trouble. While he was just examining her, she had two seizures.
She'd failed everything. There were no more options for her. Everything had been tried, except cannabis.
Here's how scientists think it might work. Marijuana is made up of two main ingredients, THC, that's the psychoactive part that makes you high, and CBD, also called cannabidiol. It's the CBD that scientists think modulates electrical and chemical activity to help quiet the excessive activity in the brain that causes seizures.
I measured it with a syringe and squirted it under her tongue. It was exciting and very nerve-wracking.
Holding Charlotte in her arms, Paige waited. An hour ticked by, and then another, and then another.
She didn't have a seizure that day. And then she didn't have a seizure that night.
Did you sit there and look at your watch? And...
Right, I thought, this is crazy. And then she didn't have one the next day. And then the next day. And I thought, that is, she would have had 100 by now.
In his compelling documentary, Weed.
You've looked at the evidence.
There is real science now out there.
He was flat out wrong about weed.
A year-long journey that changed what many of us thought about marijuana, myself included.
I think, you know, we've been terribly and systematically misled.
We used to only picture this. Then we showed you this. Medical marijuana, treating seizures, pain, dozens of other ailments.
Charlotte's doing amazing, just better and better each month.
But we learned this wasn't the end of the story. It was just the beginning.
I think we went from about 150 calls a month to over 4,000.
There are still so many issues to be addressed. The federal government says marijuana is among the most addictive drugs with no medicinal value. Many serious scientists say they're wrong.
It's a medicine.
It's the politics of pot, pitting policy against patients. Trapped in the middle, sick, qualified people who want medical marijuana but can't get it because it's illegal.
If you try to go back to Ohio with Jordan's medication,
we'll be arrested.
Here to accept the DuPont Award, please welcome CNN's Dr. Sanjay Gupta.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the judges. We're tremendously honored by this. Thank you very much. I want to thank everyone that's in the audience tonight for being here. And I want to thank the other winners. You can't help but see many of these clips and have your faith in journalism reaffirmed. Thanks to all the winners for making us want to be better. As with most things in life, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. We could not be here at all unless we were here together. This is a team of truly committed individuals. They're curious individuals for whom no question is unwarranted and no answer is too small. Bud Boltman, Melissa Dunst, Sandra Young, Carl Graff, Kristen Corrali, Tia Chester, Neil Curzada, and my partner in crime, Ronnie Selig, over here. Thank you very much. I want to thank CNN. There aren't many places, I think, that allow you to fly all over the world, talk to people who have the highest impact in any particular field, and give us the time to tell the story, the whole story. Jeff Zucker, thank you very much for allowing us to do that. I really appreciate it. Michael Bass, Rick Davis, Amy Antalis, Jen Hyde, thank you. We couldn't have done this without your support. In journalism, as in medicine, we like to investigate things. We like to see problems and try and find solutions. We want to try and add to the fund of knowledge that exists in the world for everybody, including ourselves. So with eyes wide open, it was really important to allow ourselves to be surprised by what we found. And such was the case with Weed. We found that a lot of people watched these documentaries, Weed and Weed 2, which may say more about our audience than it does the quality of our content. I'm not entirely sure. And at the risk of being known as the pot doc, let's just say this was truly an organic journey for all of us. We came to understand in the making of this documentary that for some people out there, not only does medicinal marijuana work and relieve suffering, but for many of these people, it's the only thing that works. And it would be improper, perhaps even immoral, to deny them treatment. We needed to talk less, we needed to listen more, we needed to rid ourselves of preconceived notions, we needed to dig, we needed to ignore the pit in our stomach, and we sort of realized that maybe we were uncovering something big, but also something that might make people uncomfortable. The truth. You talk about the truth business. The truth is a funny thing sometimes. It can feel foreign, it can feel awkward, it can feel difficult to say out loud, but none of that changes what it is. It is still the truth. Now, one thing I think we've all learned, this group, is that good journalism is empowered by getting yourself out of the bubble from time to time and surrounding yourself with people, maybe outside the business, who share your passions and are completely without any bias or judgment. I'm lucky to have people like that in my life. We all are. I want to thank many members of my family and my friends that are here today. I want to thank my wife
the one person who I share my early awful renditions, and somehow she always makes them somehow better. Thank you very much for that. I also, when I got this award, I don't know about the other winners, but when I got this award, the first phone call I made was to my parents. Even after 45 years, one cannot help but seek the praise of parents. My mom was excited, my dad didn't believe it. They are both here as well. Thank you. Medicine and media are sometimes embraced in this clumsy dance, and sometimes I realize now that media doesn't always have to follow. Media can lead, and if it does it well, it can make a huge difference in countless people's lives. This instrument can teach, it can illuminate, it can even inspire, but it can only do so to the extent that humans are determined to use it to those ends. Otherwise, it's merely wires and light in a box. We hope we've done you proud. Thank you very much.
The producers, did he get the baton?
Yes.
You got it, didn't you? Yes, good, great. Congratulations, well deserved. Next, two awards for local stations honoring excellent reporting in the public service. First, a year-long investigation from our second Tampa Bay winner tonight, WTSP, who uncovered a problem that impacts millions of Americans. They showed local municipalities manipulating technology to make, now get this, yellow lights shorter, thereby driving up the number of traffic tickets. In over 50 stories, reporter Noah Pransky revealed how local governments systematically abuse red light camera technology to generate millions of dollars of revenue, while politicians took contributions from the camera's manufacturer. The station dedicated time and resources to dig through thousands of public records, pushing back as agencies tried to withhold them. Interactive features on the station's website allowed viewers to find unfair lights in their communities. This series had real impact, compelling the state to backtrack and mandate longer yellow lights at every intersection in the entire state of Florida. Let's take a look at WTSP-TV Tampa Bay's Short Yellows, the Red Light Fight.
Red light cameras are a for-profit business.
James Walker's with the nonprofit National Motorists Association. He says Florida's issuing thousands of tickets a day to people who simply roll through right turns or just run out of time going straight.
I think it's totally about money. I think it's immoral. You're basically punishing safe drivers with deliberately improper engineering.
Walker says longer yellow lights would make things safer. He says adding just a half second to yellow intervals would give well-intended drivers more time to stop. Local cities in the state are also ignoring federal guidelines that suggest adding an extra half second above the minimum whenever a lot of trucks or elderly drivers are present. US 19 has lots of both. And we found other red light camera intersections with problems too. In Tampa, the yellow lights at Hillsborough in Nebraska and 50th at Adamo both change faster than the state allows. In Valrico, Hillsborough County improperly shortened the yellows on Bell Shoals Road. And both St. Pete and Oldsmar learned that they were issuing citations for $158 a pop at intersections where the yellow intervals were too short. They've since fixed the timings, but victims of the short yellows were never notified and never refunded their money. When Oldsmar lengthened the yellow light at Tampa Road and State Street, tickets plummeted by 90%.
I don't think our citizens should be penalized for yellow lights that have been artificially reduced.
State Senator Jeff Brandis tweaked a few red light camera regulations in the closing moments of this year's session, but he couldn't change the length of yellow lights. Why? You can thank red light camera company American Traffic Solutions. 10 News found they've donated more than $500,000 to political campaigns in Florida alone and upwards of $1 million lobbying. With American Traffic Solutions spokesperson Charles Torito.
What is all the lobbying money for? Are you buying influence in Tallahassee?
Not at all. What we're trying to do is educate the legislature and share with them the facts about not only the safety benefits, but the economic benefits.
But those benefits come at a price for local drivers like Shirley Nagel.
So I'm not a lawbreaker. I try not to be.
Okay, please welcome and congratulate reporter Noah Bransky.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
First and foremost, thank you, Columbia University, and thank you, judges. We are truly honored and humbled. Thank you to our team, which is the best in the business, I think. You guys, Amy, Paul, Peter, and Mel, you've done a lot of putting up with my OCD over the last couple of years, so thank you. And thank you to our other team member, which is Gannett. The corporation has been so supportive of everything we do in terms of investigative reporting, and then doubled it down in terms of doubling our presence at IRE each year. In the summer, the Investigative Reporter and Editors Conference, which is the most important tool in an investigative reporter's tool belt. You have supported and done everything we need. Let's keep it going, because that organization, I can't say enough for. They stand for watchdog reporting. They stand for making a difference in our society. A strong Fourth Estate is a stronger United States, and I hope everyone in this room takes a little bit of that with them. Our story was just a microcosm of what investigative reporting can do. So hopefully everyone, no matter what corporation, no matter what affiliation you are tonight, you take back a little stronger appreciation for investigative reporting. We need it, our country needs it, and keep up the good work, everybody. Thank you.
Well, here's a tough one coming up. The tragic death of a four-year-old sent home from foster care, despite multiple reports of abuse, led to the series of investigative reports from WLTX-TV Columbia that upended a dysfunctional child welfare department. Reporter Clark Foraker exposed many problems in the South Carolina Department of Social Services, DSS, with this thorough and sober investigation over several months, which included the death of another child under the agency's care, and the trials and convictions of those responsible. Foraker's reporting helped force the resignation of the agency's state director, brought about policy changes in the Child Protective Services Division, and increased funding to an understaffed group that advocates for kids in state care. Let's watch WLTX-TV's DSS When the System Fails.
July 1st, 2013, Richland County deputies were called to Ginyard's home. Reports say they found Robert face up, unresponsive.
Through full body x-rays, basically, we were able to determine not only an immediate traumatic injury to the child, but also a history of abuse.
Richland County Coroner Gary Watts ruled blunt force trauma to the head and body the cause of death.
There was certainly an extensive history of this.
She grabbed him, by the back of his shirt and threw him from one side of the living room to the other side of the living room. When he wouldn't stop crying, she took him upstairs and continued to beat him.
His aunt, Natalie Thompson, says she saw the abuse about 6 months before he died.
The only thing we could hear was him just calling auntie, and I left because I couldn't deal with it. And called Department of Social Service to come out then.
DSS call records and investigator reports are sealed. But Thompson says after that first call in January of 2013, she called DSS 5 more times and visited in person twice. Both cases happened in Richland County. Senator Katrina Sheely, alongside Senate colleagues investigating DSS, say there's turnover trouble.
This is a problem all over the state of South Carolina.
All because workers have too many cases. But we found our own turnover trouble in a document showing workers once employed by DSS, but no longer there. Still on the work roster with cases next to their names weeks after they left DSS. If this list is up to date, that's a problem, says child welfare attorney Jay Elliott, who's worked on child abuse issues for the past four decades.
Well, obviously, if a kid's in danger, you can't just let that kid sit there and be exposed.
We showed him that document, a confidential Richland County roster we obtained from March 30th of this year. On it, at least three employees who left the agency or were fired weeks, sometimes months before.
If you're giving out statistics about the size of caseloads, and you include these imaginary workers, these phantom workers in your count, it makes the caseload look much smaller.
Please welcome reporter Clark Foraker.
Good evening. Thank you first to the jury for inviting us here tonight. We are so thankful. And I want to start by saying that there are hundreds, thousands of child welfare workers across this country that do great, great work every day to protect kids. But our reporting uncovered a system of agencies and nonprofits that work with them and universities they have contracts with that are underfunded and ultimately failing kids. They're not doing the job well enough. It was exposed in our story through Robert Guignard Jr., a four-year-old who, as you saw, was failed on a number of occasions, and another young man named Bryson Webb, who could have been saved, we were told by a coroner. I want to thank tonight my team, who's in the row back there with the iPhones trained at the podium, Mary Beth Jacoby, Jennifer Bellamy, Darcy Strickland, and our general manager, Rich Odell, whose commitment to investigative reporting to time and resources was unwavering. And furthermore, to Gannett, who, as Noah just mentioned previously, Dave Lugi and our executive team, who were just phenomenal in supporting this work, lawyers' time. There was just nothing that we were sort of reined in on and really exposing this story. There's a lot of work to be done. I'll tell you that in December of 2014, that DSS actually took us to court for trying to get some information about a case where a foster mom under oath had admitted on the stand that she beat children. And right now, DSS is trying to close that case because we're about to expose that she may still be allowed to foster children even after that confession. There is much more work to do. Thank you again to Gannett and to the jury. We'd like to dedicate the baton tonight to Robert Guignard Jr. Thank you.
Well, we're coming to our last few awards, but I think I speak for everybody. It's been a long evening, but I think we all feel very refreshed, you know, in our own way by the commitment of our colleagues and by the excellence that we are seeing. Tonight, our last two DuPont Awards honor reporting from Frontline. Both winners broke new ground on important stories. The first is a gripping firsthand account inside Syria's civil war. Frontline and its correspondent, Syrian native Muhammad Ali, traveled into the northern war zone last winter at a pivotal moment in the raging civil war. This courageous film documents how the revolution against Bashar al-Assad had devolved into a battle between rebels and Islamic extremist factions. Syria's second front was one of the first up-close views of what would soon become a household name, ISIS. Ali gained the trust of moderate rebel groups and traveled with them over the course of several months to produce this in-depth account of the fight against ISIS and of the group's brutal power. In this excerpt of Frontline's Syria's Second Front, we will see how filmmaker Muhammad Ali got across the border into Syria and what happened when he ventured into an ISIS-controlled town, a town where ISIS publicly executes its opposition. Let's take a look.
We have just crossed the Syrian borders with Turkey. The jihadists don't like journalists, and they don't like the FSA battalions because they are accusing them that they are spies for the West. It's a very dangerous situation now.
Mohammed and the rebels are picked up in a car and driven for 7 hours through the night.
The situation is not that good as before. New groups came and they started, you know, stealing the revolution.
In November 2013, ISIS staged a show of strength in the town, parading a group of rebels captured in battle, including a rebel commander, Hassan Jazra. Locals filmed it on their cell phones. Muhammad persuades some of the rebels to sneak him in to Al-Atarab.
When I was about to enter the town, the first thing I saw was a big flag of Al-Qaeda. The only thing in my mind was that scene of seven fighters of the FSA were executed. I was sure if they catch me, and they suspect me, I will be killed.
In the town square, ISIS is holding a public rally where fighters are pledging allegiance to global jihad. Mohammed wants to film it, but the rebels say it is too dangerous. So a local man agrees to film it for him.
تعاهد الأمير على السمع والطاعة أمرتك أن تذهب إلى خلطمان تذهب إلى خلطمان أمرتك تذهب إلى دير الزور تذهب إلى دير الزور جيد طيب حط اليد في اليد كل أنا أقول وأنتم تكرروا إن شاء الله أبايع الدولة الإسلامية في العراق والشام
أبايع الدولة الإسلامية في العراق والشام
على السمع والطاعة
على السمع والطاعة
Please welcome for Frontline, producer Jamie Duran.
Thank you. Hi, you'll have to forgive me if I appear a little disjointed. I've just kind of got out of my sick bed of 5 days, pushed on a plane this morning at Heathrow. 8 hours later, I find myself here, and I have no idea what time in the morning it is in London. But it's worth it. This is a fabulous honour. In fact, it's, I think, the third time in recent years that my little company has been honoured here at Columbia. And, of course, 99% of that is down to the amazing frontline team headed by David and Rainey, supported amazingly by Andrew Metz, who was actually one of the major forces, driving forces behind the making of this film. I should mention James Jones as well, another Brit who did a great job edit producing. But the film's uniqueness really comes down to Muhammad Ali's amazing work on the ground. This was, as you saw, the first time we saw the true horror of an ISIS recruitment campaign. Campaigns that are going on, don't doubt it, every single day in Iraq and Syria at this moment. It was also, amazingly, the first time we saw ISIS on the run. Moo, as I call him, has this kind of happy knack of almost stumbling into moments of history. And he just turned up at this meeting, this day, of rebel commanders, and they were under immense pressure. ISIS had taken over the entire northwest. There was one final crossing point, and I remember it well, from the other side, the safe side. And there was one final crossing point, and that was it. And that was the only way the rebels could get in or out. And this group of men decided, in front of Moo sitting there with his camera, they were going to make a final stand. They were going to fight back. And as a result, they actually, as you saw, went in. Well, you didn't see there later on in the film, you'll see them actually going in, chasing into a camp, retaking Al-Atarab, and the first time ever giving hope to other groups that ISIS could actually be beaten. Of course, I would love to have Moo standing beside me here tonight to enjoy this honor as much as I am. Unfortunately, a man who can managed to get inside ISIS-controlled towns and villages. I couldn't get a visa for America. So I guess that's life. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Please welcome back Dean Steve Cole.
So our final award tonight honors another frontline film that probably explains why Moo couldn't get his visa. It was a film over two nights devoted to one of the most critical issues of our time, how the United States government came to monitor and collect the communications of millions of people, including ordinary Americans, and the lengths they went to hide the massive surveillance from the public. With formidable and unprecedented interviews with the highest ranking players on all sides of the story, Frontline's United States of Secrets provided historic context to the events around Edward Snowden's now famous revelations. And in this first part of the meticulous report, viewers learned about the impetus for the extraordinary data collection, including the inner thoughts of those taking part. In the second episode, Frontline revealed the secret relationship between Silicon Valley and the National Security Agency. We'll hear now from government officials, we'll hear how government officials justified their expanded surveillance of millions of Americans in this clip from Frontline, United States of Secrets.
Worst days in American
it would
history.
Be his first meeting in the Oval Office.
Prior to 9/11, I don't think I knew General Hayden. I probably knew his name. I doubt that the president knew his name.
It's a very big change for the director of NSA to suddenly have all this attention from senior officials in the White House and so forth, and I'm sure it had a major impact on Hayden.
The president had been briefed. He put his arm around General Hayden, called him his childhood nickname, Mikey.
So I walk in to see the president. It's the president and the vice president in the room. Almost certainly Condi was there as the national security advisor. Andy Card would have been there.
Cheney suggests the question, and George Bush asks it. What would you like to do that you can't already do that would help prevent another 9/11?
Hayden outlined the program. It would gather data on the phone calls and internet traffic of hundreds of millions of Americans, then search it for suspicious connections. But he was worried about whether it was legal.
And the first thing he says to me is, Mike, I understand your concerns, but there's some things we're going to have to do. And I think I have the authority to authorize you to do the things that you've outlined.
My name's Ed Snowden. I'm 29 years old. I work for Booz Allen Hamilton as an infrastructure analyst for NSA in Hawaii.
What we see is someone who is calm, rational, persuasive.
The NSA specifically targets the communications of everyone. It ingests them by default. It collects them in its system, and it filters them, and it analyzes them, and it measures them, and it stores them.
The language was clear, sympathetic, and when he did the interview, it was as if he was a media natural. So we knew that when Snowden went public, it was going to be a huge story.
Why should people care about surveillance?
Because even if you're not doing anything wrong, you're being watched and recorded.
And he sets out why he's done this thing, what his motives are, and basically sort of puts the ball in the court of the public and says, you make up your minds as to whether this is right or not.
These things need to be determined by the public, not by somebody who was simply hired by the government. This is the truth. This is what's happening. You should decide whether we need to be doing this.
Edward Snowden, according to The Guardian, is in Hong Kong.
Contractor who leaked the existence of NSA programs.
Snowden fled to Hong Kong 3 weeks ago after copying a
We knew that the minute we unveiled his identity, that he was going to have to go into hiding because the media horde was about to descend onto Hong Kong and would be looking for him, and the U.S. government would certainly be looking for him.
Here to accept the DuPont Award, please welcome longtime Frontline writer, director, and producer Michael Kirk.
I'll wait for them to come. They deserve the moment. When we receive an award, I always hope to be able to say something meaningful. I'm often disappointed in myself. By the time we finish thanking each other, it's all we've really done. Maybe tonight I can leave you with a thought or an idea, but first the thank yous. On behalf of Martin Smith and his talented collaborators at Rain Media, this crowd, my longtime partner, Michael Weiser, and Jim Gilmore, who had to leave to head to Washington to start our interviews for tomorrow morning. We're off to the next one. For Bart Gellman, who's up here, who brought his talent and reporting to our films. David Fanning and Rainey Aronson from Frontline, join me in thanking you for all of your support. Now, let me add this simple thought to the discussion of journalism we're having tonight, which has just been wonderful and is one of the great benefits of coming to this event. We all do this work because we have to. And right now in journalism, long form, short form, on the web, or over the air, we can do serious journalism. That's been proven tonight. There's nothing better than trying to get a big story right when powerful people, some of the most powerful people in the world, don't even want you to get it at all. The stakes are high, and they should be. Thank you, jurors, for recognizing what is at the heart of our endeavors. Thank the rest of you for recognizing United States of Secrets and Frontline. And thank you for choosing journalism as a career and as a calling. Thank you.
So congratulations to all of our night's winners. I think the only brief reflection that I'd like to add, been very inspired by so much of the work, but particularly by the local investigative reporting, and yet hundreds of local television stations around the country, dozens and dozens of I teams, and we have two winners from Tampa Bay, Florida. So. I think maybe those who live in the state of Florida can explain why. But I want to congratulate again all of our winners, and particularly thank Michelle and Cynthia for being with us and for giving your time. And you're all invited back to the faculty lounge for a nightcap. Good night. Thank you.